I am the secretary here for Students for Life here at UNM. So I'm just here to talk about our group very briefly before Sade and Matt go into detail about what exactly abortion is, and then also the moral behind human beings. So our main mission of our group is to abolish abortion in our lifetime. We feel like this is a realistic goal that we will succeed with. This is a picture that we took recently with all the people that are pretty consistent in our group. We have about 20 people that are pretty consistent with coming to meetings and helping us out with all of our outreach events and things like that. So Students for Life of America as a whole is the largest pro-life organization throughout the country. They work with high school and college kids to be able to outreach across their campuses and also help mothers that find themselves pregnant. And then the national conference that is held each year is the largest pro-life event in the entire world. And that happens in Washington, D.C., and they also have one in San Francisco. So our mission at UNM is to do 4 things: to educate and train, empower, serve, and change the world. So with education and training, there's events that are held here on campus to educate people on what exactly is happening with the pro-life movement. We want to educate the students because especially here at UNM, there's a lot of misconceptions and a lot of ideas that are not exactly valid towards the pro-life movement, so we want to be here to dialogue with them and make sure that we have a presence at every event possible so that we can get on the media and be shown that we are a pro-life group here at UNM. So here's a couple events that we had. Last semester we did the Planned Parenthood Project, so this is right by the duck pond. The things that you see on the floor actually crosses. They were supposed to be lined up, standing up. But we laid them out on the floor, and there were 897, I want to say, and they represented the amount of children that would lose their lives that day. I don't know what happened. So the Planned Parenthood Project, we also have Pregnant on Campus, which is our other half of our group's outreach program. We had 2 tables set up, and it was actually a very successful event that happened. We also do What Has Roe Done For Us? It pretty much just, it's a display that we give on campus that describes exactly what happened with Roe versus Wade and how it's affecting today's society. And then the We Care display. This was actually, it made the news, I want to say, last semester. I wasn't here for it, but the rest of our group put it on, and it was, we talked about sexual assault and discussing cases of rape and domestic violence. And it got UNM very aware of the fact that we do care about women and we don't forget about the unforeseen circumstances. So another event that we did this past semester, Planned Parenthood had their rally here on campus right outside the sub, and this was when the whole Women Betrayed movement was coming in, and so we decided to black out their event. We got on into their rally directly and we made the media. We tried dialoguing with them, but we made sure to have our presence there to show that we're not going to put up with that here on campus. So another cool thing, I believe that this happened over the summer. Congressman Steve Pierce actually was outside of Planned Parenthood during this rally, and it was for the Women Betrayed. So we made our presence there, and it was really cool. So another thing that we do on campus is empowering women. So we want to be able to show pregnant women specifically that they are able to do both. They can be on campus and be pregnant and be a parent and do well in school all at the same time. So we do pregnant on campus every Friday, and we just want to empower women and empower their families and make sure that they are successful. There's our table. And then to serve, we want to be active in the community, and then we're always looking for more organizations and ministries to pair up with. We are partnered with over 20 organizations, and that number is growing to this day. We also work with the adoption centers. The Christian Children's Home is in Portales, and we're directly affiliated with them. And I think we're also involved with 2 others that are here in Albuquerque. Sidewalk advocating. We had a sidewalk advocating training not that long ago, so most of the people in our group are we are able to actually be out on the sidewalks outside of the abortion clinics and be able to talk to women one-on-one and be able to help them through whatever situation they find themselves in. We also work with the pregnancy resource centers, CareNet, Women's Pregnancy Options, Birthright, all those We work directly with them to be able to refer women. So if you get a woman that does come up to the table, we know exactly where to send her. Global Parenting is now the new parenting group here on campus that's ran through our Family Studies program here at UNM. And so they're here to also just support women that do find themselves pregnant and students. And then, of course, we have post-abortive care as well. So if we are confronted with a woman that is post-abortive, there's so many different recovery ministries that are able to help her. And once again, to change the world, we do highly believe that abortion will be abolished in our lifetime. So that's our group.
Hi everyone, my name is Matt Drum. I'm the Vice President of Students for Life. We divvied up all of our talks just because we like sharing things. So give me 1 second. Okay. I never used OneDrive, but I think it's cool. Okay, so I'm actually not going to give the ethics. I'm going to just mainly talk about what is abortion, kind of the biology of the unborn, and a little bit of embryology, and then the different abortion procedures. Oops. Oh. Really tricky to use. Anyways, okay, so human development. When does life begin? Wow. So this is from an old textbook, but new textbooks say just about the same thing. Sade quotes 2003 one in her presentation too. I'll read it for you. The development of a human being begins with fertilization, a process by which two highly specialized cells, the spermatozoon and from the male and the oocyte, I think, from the female, unite to give rise to a new organism, the zygote. So that's from Medical Embryology, 3rd edition, Williams and Wilkins, 1975. So that was the year after Roe v. Wade happened. That was the year after abortion became legal in America. So the reason we have that is just so people realize that the question whether or not the unborn was biologically human was never really something that was brought up at Roe v. Wade. Roe versus Wade was more based on the idea that the unborn isn't a person with rights, but it was never questioned biologically. So here's human development for the first 9 weeks. Starts with the zygote, goes all the way up, and I think the heart starts beating from anywhere from 3 to 5 weeks, and a lot of other things happen. They have pretty much all their parts. Shelly, maybe you can talk more about that. Mm-hmm. I just thought the pictures were cool. I'm not like the expert on this stuff. And then here's from 940 weeks. One thing that's important to note, in New Mexico, it's actually legal to have an abortion through all 9 months of pregnancy. So that means up until the day of birth, as long as it's in the mother. So up to there. And there's actually a clinic called Southwestern's Women's Options, which is just down the street on Lomas, who performs them up to the 40th week and or later if needed. I have any questions, so I can stop this for a different presentation. Does anyone have any questions? Feel free to ask. Okay, so there are 3 different kinds of loss during pregnancies. So there's miscarriage, there's ectopic pregnancies, and then there's abortion. One of them is an immoral act, and 2 of them are not immoral acts, because the woman has no control over them. So first one with miscarriage. So it's the loss of an embryo or fetus before the 20th week of pregnancy. Most miscarriages occur during the first 14 weeks of pregnancy. The medical term, or a medical term for miscarriage, is spontaneous abortion. So if you hear the word spontaneous abortion, that isn't the same as an elective abortion where a woman goes to Planned Parenthood. That's something that a woman has no control over, and it's usually a really sad event, and we need to show compassion to people who've had miscarriages. The next is ectopic pregnancy. So this is where the fertilized egg implants a location other than the uterus. Ectopic just means in an abnormal place or position. And it's most common in the fallopian tube. So I think the picture's coming up here. But it can also implant, so the fertilized egg can implant itself in the ovary, abdomen, cervical canal, a lot of just strange places. And it can be really dangerous for the woman. So this is what I was talking about. Those little purple things, that's the baby. Those are just places that can implant. A really common one is a fallopian tube, like I said, and the way that doctors will handle that, because it is a medical issue for the mother and she could die from it, is they remove the fallopian tube and the baby dies through the process. One thing that's important to note is this is different than an abortion because this is a life-saving procedure with the intention of saving both the mother's life and the child's life. but one has to die in the process, unfortunately. But the intent is still there, that both lives are equally valuable and both are should be saved if they can. Okay, so what is abortion? We try to use non-biased sources of Students for Life because we get a lot of hate for stuff. But Oxford English Dictionary defines an abortion as the expulsion of an embryo or fetus, i.e. unborn child, from the womb before a child is capable of surviving outside of the womb. And before we begin, this is from Pope St. John Paul II in Evangelium Vitae, talking about women who've had abortions. He says, the Church is aware of the many factors which may have influenced your decision, and she does not doubt that in many cases it was a painful and even shattering decision. The Father of Mercies is ready to give you his forgiveness and his peace in the sacrament of reconciliation. To the same Father and his mercy, you can, with sure hope, entrust your child. So the Church is very merciful. Okay, so there are two different types of abortion. There's medical and there's surgical abortions. Medical abortion is the pill, and there are a few different types of surgical abortions, which we'll cover. So there are a couple different pills involved with the medical abortion. There's mifepristone, which is taken in the form of a pill. It works by blocking the hormone progesterone, which is necessary to sustain the pregnancy. Without this hormone, the lining of the uterus breaks down, the cervix softens, and bleeding begins. And then the next pill is misoprostol. Within a few days after taking either mifepristone or methotrexate, a drug with similar effects, a second drug, misoprostol, is taken. Misoprostol tablets, which may be placed either into the vagina, between the cheek and gum, or swallowed, cause the uterus to contract and empty, and this ends the pregnancy. So it's kind of a two-stage thing. And this is from prochoice.org, National Abortion Federation website. So again, we like to use either non-biased or actually hostile sources for what we cite. So that's medical abortion. This is surgical abortion. There's suction curettage, and this is a quote by, is it Gosnell? I think it may have been Gosnell. It was in a court case by an abortionist. And so he says, well, when we do a suction curettage abortion, you know, roughly one of two of three things is going to happen during the abortion. One would be is that the catheter, as it approaches the fetus, you know, tears it and kills it at that instant inside the uterus. The second would be that the fetus is small enough and the catheter is large enough that the fetus passes through the catheter and either dies in transit as it's passing through the catheter or dies in the suction bottle after it's actually all the way out. And so that was a testimony, and it was by, I think it was Kermit Gosnell. I don't remember. I'll get back to you on that.
No, so Gosnell was in Philadelphia.
I'm sorry?
Gosnell was in Philadelphia.
His case was only a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that's 99.
Oh, shoot. Oh, never mind. I'm thinking of another
but
one.
But it's somebody like him.
Yeah, it was, you know, an abortionist. So this is the machine. So it was saying, basically, it'll go through a tube, the baby, and it'll either die in transit through the tube if it's not killed instantly, or it'll die in the those little jars there. Now, fair warning, it's a little late, but a lot of the descriptions are really graphic. Sorry. So the next is dilation and evacuation, or DNE. Carhart, I think it was Carhart. During a pregnancy's, and this is another quote, during a pregnancy's second trimester, from 12 to 24 weeks, the most common abortion procedure is dilation and evacuation, or DNE, which involves dilation of the cervix, removal of at least some of the fetal tissue using non-vacuum surgical instruments, and after the 15th week, the potential need for instrumental dismemberment of the fetus or the collapse of fetal parts to facilitate evacuation from the uterus. When such dismemberment is necessary, it typically occurs as the doctor pulls a portion of the fetus through the cervix into the birth canal. Thus, Steinberg versus Carhart. And these are the tools that's referring to. So this syringe is really long when they inject it through the mother's abdomen, and they use I think these to basically grab and pull the baby apart, pretty much piece by piece. And I used to have diagrams in this, but I excluded it because I was giving it for ninth graders. But you get the idea, I think. And actually, I heard another testimony from a doctor that said basically when they grab a hold of something, those clamps never really let go. And then another way they know that it was a successful procedure or that they've Which part they've got is when they clamp down on something, they should see white stuff coming out, and that would be the baby's brains, and that's how they know they grabbed the baby's head. They have to get all the pieces out because it can cause the mother an infection. Oops, I went too far. Late-term abortion. Could you hit back down? Just the back arrow. Thanks, Jen. Okay, so late-term abortions. And remember, these are legal in New Mexico. So, digoxin. Again, from Steinberg versus Carhart. Some physicians use intrafetal potassium chloride or digoxin to induce fetal demise prior to a late DNE. So that's after 20 weeks, to facilitate evacuation. And this is a quote that used to be on drtiller.com. He was another late-term abortionist who actually passed away. Your cervix will be opened over a 1 to 4 day period with repeated insertions of sponge-like sticks called laminaria. When your cervix is open adequately, labor will be induced with naturally occurring hormones. So basically, the idea is that they inject digoxin into the through the mother's abdomen or wherever they can reach the baby. They'll inject it either into the fetus or into the uterine sac and the amniotic fluid. And so basically, it's just a poison, and it'll either kill the baby if they inject it into it, or if it's in the amniotic fluid or amniotic sac, then it'll basically just marinate the baby until it's ready to be delivered and it's soft enough that it can pass naturally. The way they have it, the way Southwestern Women's Options does it is they'll usually put a woman in a hotel and for like 2 or 3 days, that's about how long the process takes, and they'll tell her that once she feels the baby coming to just sit on the toilet, don't look, and then call them when she's having, giving labor, or going through labor. And they'll come and they'll clean it all up. And they tell her specifically, don't look at the baby, I think because it'd be a really traumatic event. Yes.
And right. Potassium chloride causes really severe chemical burns.
It's like acid.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It's mostly like a heart attack. They
induce the baby to have a heart attack.
Mm-hmm. And so this is more tools. So that's the laminaria. That's what they keep things open with. And then digoxin, they inject it with a long needle, like I said, through the abdomen or wherever they can reach the easiest. Okay, any questions? Sorry, that was really tough.
Yeah. So, yes. The videos about Planned Parenthood, where they're selling the organs, mm-hmm. where did that
what
fit
What procedure?
In?
So
the one with the clamps?
Yeah, so it would probably be a dilation and evacuation. That's where they can get the pieces. And I think that's where kind of the trickiness with them tampering with their abortion method or procedures, which is illegal, came into play, because instead of going through the, you know, the medical procedure in order to get everything out, they were kind of salvaging pieces and
right.
parts and being
right.
careful.
They were deliberately
yeah.
picking out organs.
Yeah, and that's where she said, right, and that's where she said, you know, I try to crush it above or I try to crush below. That's what she's like. Yeah. Right.
There's also been evidence in the videos that Planned Parenthood has been performing illegal abortions, which are late-term abortions, to salvage the baby in whole so that they can have more organs to give away. So we're not sure exactly how far, you know, what kind of abortions they're performing to give the organs, but there is talk of late-term abortions in their videos too.
The Southwest Clinic had an abortion last year of an Orthodox Jewish woman, which no rabbi would have given her permission for this, because she was in her last week of pregnancy. All she had to do was deliver the baby and give it to somebody. And then they pierced her uterus. They damaged her. I don't think she's going to be able to carry children in the future.
She had a hysterectomy.
What happened to her?
She ended up having a full hysterectomy. So
she had a full hysterectomy because of that late-term abortion. But nothing's done to these doctors. There's no, they don't file malpractice charges against them for...
It's a slap on the wrist.
A slap on the wrist.
It's definitely an extremely dangerous procedure.
Yes,
just the
horrible.
Fact that it's so unnatural. You know, it never is supposed to happen biologically or evolutionarily or anything like that. And not to mention just the methods. It's actually a really barbaric process. And people like to act like it's you know, it's a medical, like it's doctors taking care of a woman. But when you actually look into it, I mean, you guys can see it's pretty barbaric. So let's see. You know, a couple more slides. Okay, so here are some catechism quotes about abortion. It's almost like it doesn't need to be said at this point, but you guys can read those. I don't know if I should read them all. You want me to? So human life must be respected and protected absolutely from the moment of conception. From the first moment of his existence, a human being must be recognized as having the rights of a person, among which is the inviolable right of every innocent being to life. Since the first century, the Church has affirmed the moral evil and of every procured abortion. This teaching has not changed and remains unchangeable. Direct abortion, that is to say, abortion willed either as an end or a means, is gravely contrary to moral law. And then the last quote I have is, from its conception, the child has a right to life. Direct abortion, that is, abortion willed as an end or as a means, is a criminal, quote, practice, gravely contrary to the moral law. So, I'm saying the same thing. Oops, clicked too much. Can you go back? Mm-hmm. And this is, I had other things in this slide. Oh, shoot. I'll skip through that. No, I'll just keep skipping through. Sorry, I had it on all pro-life topics, and so I include suicide, euthanasia, and physician. Okay, so here we go. As Catholics, how do we respond to this issue? So we have a couple of tools in our belt. We have science, we have all the biology and all the scientific facts on our side. This is actually where we win, and it's kind of not even really disputable. And then we also have philosophy. You guys are really good at that already. This is all out of order, I'm sorry. Essential skills. Oh, yeah, that's it. So I actually have one more quote, and the picture didn't come out before I put show. It's by Peter Crave. Does anyone know who that is? And I think I have it memorized. I'll try. He said, abortion is the Antichrist's demonic parody of the Eucharist, which is why it uses its same words, this is my body, with a blasphemously opposite meaning. And so I thought as Catholics that would be a really cool quote. Because one of them says, this is my body, which given up for you, I give and I sacrifice for you. And the other says, sacrifice you for the sake of myself. So that just really convicted me. I was listening to one of his talks. And that's it. And here's Shade, and she'll give you guys how to answer abortion and how to talk about it in a nice way, in a philosophical way. Sorry, that was really gruesome and really sad to talk about. I wish I could have made jokes like I usually do when I present, but that wasn't really a joke. So, thanks.
All right, can I just scroll up?
I got you. Oh yeah, you're in the other tab. OneDrive is amazing.
Hi guys, I'm Sade. I'm the president of Students for Life. I'm going to just give a quick bio about me because I don't know a lot of you. I'm the president now, been for the last year, and I'm studying journalism. I want to be a pro-life journalist. If you guys read like Life Site News or Life Action, that's kind of what I want to be doing. I was actually raised Muslim, and I was forced to be Muslim the last 3 years. And when I was living in Europe with my mom, and I moved back to America with my dad, and a few years later, I just was really influenced and invested by a believer in the Bible, and I became Christian, and I wasn't very involved in the pro-life movement. I never thought about abortion until I came to UNM, and it was actually because of the Pregnant on Campus table I started, you know, asking questions when Samantha Serrano was the president, and just got thinking, abortion is legal in our state up to 9 months, like Matt was saying. And it's really horrific, and I wanted to be part of abolishing it in all stages of pregnancy. And I want to help you guys if you want to get involved with our mission. We would always love to have you at our meetings, and what we're going to do tonight, as quickly as I can, is just give you guys some tips when you're talking to students on campus or in your community or even your family. Before I start the presentation, I just wanted to address a few things that Matt said. With late-term abortion, we have to understand that it is, according to a lot of sources that are very new, a lot of studies, if you get an abortion after 20 weeks, your chances for maternal death is actually 50% higher than carrying to term, which is 12% maternal death if you carry the baby to term and deliver naturally. So late-term abortion is very dangerous. I actually was able to write a 14-page research paper last semester in my family studies class on the negative effects of abortion. So if you guys want that to kind of read and just understand how it really affects women even in the first trimester, I would love to send that to you. So I think with that being said, I'm just going to delve into the apologetics training. Before I start, this is a great quote from G.K. Chesterton. It is generally the man who is not ready to argue who is ready to sneer. So we kind of have that mentality before you talk about abortion, because it's a very emotional and, controversial topic, people like to say. I mean, we know that it's wrong, but a lot of people think that it's controversial, that they're, you know, it's not black and white. Before we talk about it with anybody, we need to be prepared. We need to have the right tools, and we need to have the right spirit and the right mind. So we need to be walking into these conversations with love, with humility, and with truth. Okay? Do I click or just scroll?
Yeah,
okay.
Sorry. Don't click twice.
Okay. So, this is the most important question when you're talking to someone. What is the unborn? Okay, you have a lot of people say, it's just a clump of cells. It's a human, but it's not a person. It's not a person until this stage or this stage. So whenever you're talking to someone, this is the question that you need to always bring the argument back to. What is the unborn? So Matt talked a lot about biology. Science says that we are human from the moment of fertilization or conception. Philosophy says we are human because of what we are, not what we do. And kind of to elaborate on that, we are human because of what we are. We have two human parents and we have human DNA. So that makes us human. We don't have to do anything to become human, like breathe on our own or be big enough. And the conclusion is, if the unborn are human, then don't they deserve the same rights that we have as humans? Okay, so these are the biggest mistakes in the pro-choice arguments, and I want you guys to know this, you can pick it out right away. So the pro-choice or pro-abort activists that come and talk to you, they already assume the inhumanity of the unborn. So you hear people say, well, it's not alive, it's not a human. We actually went to San Francisco for the National Walk for Life about a week or two ago, and outside of our conference, there were about 7 protesters with Stop Patriarchy, and they were handing out brochures that said, a fetus is not a baby. And then in their brochure, they had pictures of embryos and fetuses that show how human they look, and they had no sources from what they were talking about. So they assume inhumanity of the unborn, despite all the evidence. And our goal is to just bring it back. Well, what is the unborn? If it's not human, what is it? You know. Another mistake is they only use emotional or subjective arguments. A lot of people will say, well, abortion might be wrong for you, but it's not wrong for me. Or, I would never have an abortion even though I know it's wrong. So we have to point out, if you think abortion is wrong in any circumstance, can we kind of agree that it's objectively wrong? There are, you know, is it right to murder you right now? And, you know, most people would say, no, it's not right. So we can say that there are absolutes, and that we can agree on that. And just because someone likes to do something or just because someone thinks it's okay doesn't mean that it's okay. And we can take that back to slavery. Just because slavery was legal doesn't mean that it was okay. Or just because people like to look at child pornography, or just because people like to rape women or torture toddlers, doesn't mean that it's okay. And another mistake that pro-choice advocates make is they make empty claims, such as women have a right to choose. And when someone says that, we need to stop and agree. Like, yes, women have a lot of rights, and they should have rights, like to vote and to be paid equally, to be in the workforce. Women do have rights, but when the right to choose results in killing a human, ending a life, that's when we have to draw the line. So, Matt already gave you a great quote, but I just wanted to leave this with you. From the moment of conception, the unborn are complete, whole, distinct, and living human beings. And this is a quote from the developing human. You can see the source underneath, but human life begins at fertilization. A zygote is the beginning of a new human being, i.e. an embryo. You will have people that will look at this quote. I've had many people, and Ali and Matt and Elena and Bree, we've all sat at the table and people have read these quotes and they say, I don't believe it. I think science is wrong. So with those, it's kind of difficult, but most people, when they see this, they will agree. You know, if biology says it's human, it's human. And I'm just gonna skip this. Okay, so let's look at philosophy. Like I said, philosophy says we are human based on what we are, not what we do. And these are some great tactics if you're talking to someone that, you know, maybe says, well, I think you're human when you are viable. So maybe at 21 weeks, 22 weeks, when you can actually live outside the womb, that's when you become a person. Or when you're born, that's when you become a person. So Jay Watts is a pro-life apologist, and this whole slideshow, I give him credit. This is an actual kind of activity that he gave us. So it's called the timeline discussion. So when you're talking to someone that thinks abortion is okay, maybe in the first trimester or just the second trimester and first trimester, and they don't understand that you're a person from the moment of conception, it's great to ask them, well, think back to when you were 6 years old or 10 years old. Were you, you might have different appearances and different likes, but were you still Allie Garcia when you were 6 or when you were 10? You didn't change your identity. You might have changed qualities about yourself and aspects about yourself, but you were still the same human being. And you can even take it back further from when you were in the womb, or the first ultrasound that your mom had, or at the moment of conception. So we know that the moment of conception, the complete human DNA is already present. And we already have all of the qualities in our DNA makeup that make us who we are. So we can argue with that information. We were the same person then as we are now. We may look different, we may be in a different environment, but we are still the same person. And this is just what I was saying, the substance view. You are valued because of what you are, not because of what you can do. So a great analogy to give someone would be, you know, say you're driving down the street on Central and you notice that a bug flies into your windshield. You know, what's your response going to be? Are you going to stop the car and cry and, you know, repent of that? No, because, I mean, God created the insects, but we have we have more value than insects. We understand that there's a difference in value, and we're not going to cry when a bug dies. If it were a dog, yes, you would cry. I hope everyone would cry if they hit a dog, or at least get out and try to help it. Matt's like, no, bad. but yeah, we understand that would be, you know, a very difficult situation compared to hitting an insect, okay? But when it comes to a child, say a child doesn't look both ways and they cross the street and you hit them and they die. I mean, that's tragic. That would change your whole life. So basically, this all boils down to the difference in value. We have a different moral standard for animals, say, if they kill another animal, than we would for a human that kills another human. If we see an animal eating another animal, we're not going to imprison that animal for what they did. That's their nature. But us, we are human beings, and we have to be held to a higher moral ground. So the diagnostic question, would it be objectively wrong to murder you right now? And if someone talks to you and they say no, then that's when you need to stop worrying about abortion for a minute and have a heart-to-heart with these people. So, I'm sure we all have stories, but during student orientation this last semester, I spoke to this woman, young lady. She was very concerned about population control, just about, like, you know, the lack of resources, and she thought that population control was necessary to preserve resources. And what she told me, you should even kill newborns, because we don't have enough resources. You should even kill disabled people. We don't have enough resources. And at that point, I completely stopped talking about abortion, because this woman needed to have a talk about faith. She needed to know what God says about humans and how they're valuable. And I did. I stepped aside and I told her, you know, do you know that you're valuable? Do you know that you were created, like, uniquely, and you have a value and you're treasured by God, and that your life matters? And of course, she doesn't believe that. So that's when you kind of need to just, you know, put aside abortion for just a minute and try to talk to them person to person. But if they can agree, yes, it's wrong for you to kill me right now, then we can agree. We can find some common ground, which is a good thing to remember. Common ground is we can agree that there are objective rights and wrongs. And then always go back to, well, then, you know, what is the abhorrent? Can you agree that it's wrong to kill human if it's human? Okay, so this is kind of where we get a little more into the apologetic training. If you guys have paper and pencils, I would recommend writing this down if you want. So Scott Klusendorf, with the Case for Life, he trains so many people. I don't know if you guys know who Stephanie Gray is. She's an author, but she went through his program, and he trained her to be a great apologist. He actually offers online courses right now, just training people with great arguments. But this is a quote from him. So, in the past, we used to discriminate on the basis of skin color and gender, and we still do at times. But now, with elective abortion, we discriminate on the basis of size, level of development, location, and degree of dependency. We simply swapped one form of bigotry to another. Scott is in charge of the acronym SLID. And that's what we're going to be talking about for the next few minutes. So, S, size. A lot of people will argue abortion is okay because the fetus is small. You might hear them, no, it's not okay if they're 20 weeks, but if they're 8 weeks, they're smaller. So then it's okay. So we like to say, well, we don't see size as a value system. Intrinsically, we are all the same. Okay, so just because my baby, who's one, is smaller than me, doesn't mean that his life is less valuable. Or just because I'm 5 feet tall and Matt is like 7 feet tall, but he's tall, it doesn't mean I'm less valuable because I'm short. So we just like to point that out. Your size does not make you more valuable or less valuable. Level of development. Maturity makes you a person, which is false because we know that there are teenagers that are not mature, living, you know, with some questionable lifestyles right now, but they still are persons and they still are valuable. We also know that, you know, maybe the fetus at, say, 8 weeks, you know, they have the heart, they have the organs and the fingers and the fingerprints and the eyes, but they aren't viable. They're not able to survive outside the womb. Maybe they're not as matured, but they still are human, and that's when we have to understand that you're not less human because you're not mature yet. You need that time to develop. And just on a side note, Christina Freeman, I'm sure you guys all know who that is, she said this great analogy one time, like a year ago, and it always stood out to me. And I don't know where she got it, but she likes to compare the unborn to a Polaroid picture. And I'm sure all of you know what a Polaroid picture is, but when you take the picture, the photo paper comes out blank. But we know that there's already a picture there. We just need to give it some time to develop and mature. The picture will be there. But we wouldn't say that just because it's not there doesn't mean that the image wasn't captured. So that's we bring that back to the unborn. Maybe you don't see the unborn yet. Maybe it's not fully developed, but we know that it's there. We know that it's growing. It just needs time to develop. One of the best arguments is, this is a great one. So people like to say because the fetuses are not conscious, they're not self-aware, they're not persons. I actually just talked to someone this last week who said that. And a good thing to point out is we don't gain self-consciousness or self-awareness until we're 18 months old. So I have a 14-month-old, so I always like to bring it back to, well, you know, my son isn't self-aware, so does that make him not human? And I actually talked to someone who was completely like, I don't know, like, you know, he got really frazzled and he didn't know what to say. And it's because we understand that it doesn't matter if you're self-aware or not, you are human. People who are, you know, maybe on life support, they're in a coma. They are not self-aware at that moment. They still are human. Environment. Where you are does not give you value. So if you're in the womb or you're outside of the womb or you're in a different country that maybe some cultures look down on, we understand that as humans we are all valuable. And dependency. A degree of dependence does not make you less valuable. So a lot of people like to use this one as well. The biggest argument is, well, I shouldn't have to be enslaved to be pregnant if something like a leech is going to need my body to survive. I mean, that's just a sad argument, but people say that. So just because the fetus depends on the mother until about 22 weeks in our society makes it less valuable, whereas after 22 weeks it could depend on technology to survive. So we like to kind of bring it back to, well, you know, what about people that are on life support right now? They need all that help. They need that that intervention. What about newborns? You can't leave a newborn in their crib and all day. It will die eventually. It needs to be fed. It needs to be held. There have been studies back in the 70s, I believe, in Romania and foster cares where these babies were not being held. They were only being fed, but they had no physical interaction, no love. Whereas other babies were, and those babies were actually more likely to die. So that just shows that not only in the womb, but outside the womb, people need that physical interaction, they need that love, and they need that support. So just because someone depends on you doesn't mean that you're less valuable. And I'm sure all of us can say that we in some way depend on someone in our life. You know, maybe not completely to survive, but, you know, to be happy or to interact with, to share our feelings or, you know, just anything like that. So we're not less valuable because we depend on people. It's just the human race, we depend on each other for support and encouragement. Okay, so three simple steps when you're talking to someone. Acknowledge their argument. A lot of people say, well, abortion should be legal if the mother is perhaps in an abusive relationship. Okay, So we like to acknowledge their stance on, you know, abusive relationships. I agree that if a woman is in an abusive relationship, that is sad and that is hard, and we need to help her. The best response is to take her out of that relationship instead of ending the pregnancy, the life of the baby. A lot of women will say, we need equality for women, and we can say, I agree, equality for women is important, perhaps in the marketplace or in how they're being paid, voting, that's important, but if it ends a life, that's where we have to draw the line. Or what about privacy is important? A woman deserves privacy between her and her doctor when it comes to abortion. And we can argue, yes, privacy is important. You might not want people to know your lab results if you had an STD test or if you had a pregnancy test. You have that right for privacy. But when it comes to ending a life, that's where we have to draw the line. Rape is injustice. What if the mother is raped? She should be allowed to have an abortion. Yes, rape is awful. We agree with that. That is so difficult, a difficult situation. It's evil. We need to take that head on with love and compassion, but we don't need to kill the baby that was innocent in the process. And I said poverty already. Trotting out the toddler is a great tactic, and this is Trent Horn, correct?
I don't know.
It's, I think, like Trent Horn. Or I might be mistaken on who.
I think it's JFA. Like,
okay.
More
okay.
Originally.
But trotting out the toddler is probably the best way that you can talk to someone about abortion. I love it. It always kind of like cycles the conversation back to trotting out the toddler. So we can authorize. Okay, I'm sorry. So I'm going to go back. So if a woman says, we need equality in the marketplace, so I should be allowed to have an abortion because being pregnant would mean I'd have to quit my job. And then I wouldn't be able to work like a man would, and that's not fair. So we can agree that equality for women is a good thing, right? We support women working if they want to work. But would you kill your two-year-old if that two-year-old was enabling you from working? Say your child care fell through, okay? So you're having issues maybe applying for CYFD to get that child care assistance, and you couldn't put your baby in child care. Would it be okay to kill your two-year-old so you can work? Of course not. Okay, so what about if a two-year-old is being abused by her father? And this is with privacy. Privacy is very important for women and their doctors, okay? So we can agree privacy is important, but a good analogy is, what if you know that your neighbor is abusing their two-year-old daughter? That's in the privacy of their own home. Would you say it would be okay to go into that home, maybe with some authorities, and have that investigated, and have him taken out and be punished? Yes? Yeah, it's okay, even though that's the privacy of his own home, we would agree that that's okay. So privacy, kind of, there's lines that you have to cross, you know, when it's an injustice against a human being, we have to make that differentiation. And then another one that I said, what if a mother is raped and she gets pregnant, she should be allowed to have an abortion. So we often like to draw this back again to the toddler. What if the mother chose life and for her whole pregnancy she was happy? She was overcoming that rape incident that happened. She had the baby. Everything was fine. At 2 years old, looked just like the rapist. Would it be okay for her to kill the baby because she couldn't stand to look at the baby? I mean, that's hard to look at. A baby looks just like your rapist. It wouldn't be okay because it's a human being. And then another example with poverty. If a woman is fine during her pregnancy, and then say when her baby is 2 years old, her husband loses his job, maybe she loses her job, or you know, just variables happen in their life and they're actually living in poverty now. They can't support their child without any help. Would it be okay to kill that child, that 2-year-old? No, because they're a human being. So we're trotting out the toddler. Oh, can you go back? Sorry. We're trotting out the toddler. We like to take these arguments that they throw at us, poverty, rape, privacy, equality, things like that. We like to apply it to the 2-year-old analogy, and then bring it back to the unborn. If it's not okay to kill a 2-year-old because you were raped, why is it okay to kill a baby in the womb if it is human? So we like to understand, you know, what is different, what is the difference between an unborn baby and a baby that's outside of the womb that is born? Okay, I'd just like to talk about rape really quick. So just so you know, on Planned Parenthood's website, it says abortions in cases of rape and incest are actually less than 1% of all abortions happen in those instances. So it's, and I understand maybe not all of them are reported, but we are dealing with a very small number when it comes to rape or incest. When someone tells you, you know, what about rape? you know, you should be able to have an abortion. We need to stop really quick and ask them, maybe, like, do you know anyone that's been raped? Maybe they're a victim of rape and they just need someone to talk to. We need to have compassion and love. We need to meet them where they're at. Rape is awful. A lot of us might have been in here or out there have been victims of sexual assault, and we need to understand that that's awful, and that we need to deal with that first before we even go to the abortion topic. Meet them where they're at is very important. It's not fair if a woman is raped and impregnated to be a mother. It's not, that's what they say. So we go back, it's not fair that you were raped or that the woman was raped. We need to always bring it back to rape. This is the issue. It's not that the baby is the issue, it's that you were raped or this person was raped. That's the issue. And what I like to ask, don't you think that we should be giving the rapist more penalties and more punishment for raping this woman than actually the baby that had nothing, had no part in the rape at all? Shouldn't we be putting our laws and our focus on the rapist more than the baby? And again, trotting out the toddler, bringing it back to the unborn. And, you know, like to end with, we cannot, just because you were raped, that's not going, just because you were raped and impregnated, an abortion is not going to unrape you. Two evils do not make you wrong. You have a chance to make a great decision to give life to a baby and overcome this rape. There have been so many stories of women that have been raped. You can see them on, like, Lifesite News or Conceived in Rape documentary, where women have chosen life. And they understand abortion would never have unraped them, but actually having the baby, that decision to give them life, just empowered them, and it gave them so much more strength and hope that they made a good decision out of something that was evil. And that's what I was just saying. How many of you guys think we should kill the rapist? Nobody, right? Because that's not our place, okay? In some cultures, they kill the woman that's been raped because she's seen as dirty and defiled, and she will not be wanted by anyone. So, we can agree that we will not kill the rapist, right? That's not our place. We do not kill the woman. So, why is it okay to kill the child? That's a good question to ask people, and I think some people actually think seriously about that. And Matt talked about life of the mother, and he did a great job. He kind of like talked about everything already, but I just wanted to make one point to you guys. When people say life of the mother, they should consider abortion, we like to say a few things. First of all, an abortion clinic is not prepared to save a life, okay? They're not licensed, they're not prepared medically to actually save a woman's life if she's dying during her pregnancy. So better option is she needs to go to a hospital to be helped, okay? So pre-viability, in our society today with our technology, viability now is 22 weeks. So this isn't in other countries, this is just here. So pre-viability, what Matt was talking about, it might be an ectopic pregnancy. There actually is no way to save a child, unfortunately. And I hope that with better technology in the next few years, we can actually make that happen. But like he said, there is natural evil versus moral evil. So we need to save the mother, and in that, the baby does die, but the intention is not to end the baby's life. It's to save the mother and the baby, but we're just not able to yet. Post-viability, the option to tell women, if you're ever at the late-term abortion clinic or if you're ever talking to someone about late-term abortion, is that they can actually go to the hospital and have an emergency C-section. And this can be done in 10 to 30 minutes. I've met women that have had emergency C-sections post-viability. And it's 10 to 30 minutes. They can save the baby's life and the mother's life. Hopefully the baby's life, but most recently we can. And the difference with this is the late-term abortion clinics, they know that the baby is viable, but they're still killing them, which, and it's an injustice any time of the pregnancy, but to know that they can survive outside the womb and to not let someone else maybe adopt the baby, that's a true injustice. And we need to be educating people that, no, late-term abortion is not necessary. No abortion is necessary. The late-term abortion, if the woman does not want to have the baby, she can have an emergency C-section and give the baby up for adoption right away. This compares to, like Matt said, about a 3 or 4 day long process of a late-term abortion. And it's safer for the woman than a late-term abortion. That's basically the end of the apologetics training. So what we want to do now is I'm going to bring Matt and Allie up here. And we're going to kind of do like a role play. And I want you guys to think of some arguments. Maybe they're arguments that I already mentioned, like rape, poverty, incest, life of the mother. Things that you didn't really catch on, you didn't really understand, like how to best argue that. And please ask us what arguments stand out to you that you've heard, and we would like to show you how to have that conversation. So would you guys like to come over? So who wants to be, Matt, you're good at being frustrated. So side note, when I always tell the story, but when Samantha Serrano and I were friends, like I met her, Matt and her were dating still, and they came to my apartment because Samantha was going to train me what I just did with you guys. And Matt came over, and he was the pro-choice woman. And I was new to this. I was like, okay, like, I had my notes, and I was like, okay, trotting out the toddler, okay, meet them where they're at. I was, like, ready to go. And Matt's like, how dare you come in here? And he's, like, yelling at me. And I was like, oh, my God, I was not expecting this. So we're not going to act like that right now with you guys. If you have any questions, we're going to be civil. Matt, don't be a crazy pro-choice woman. All right,
so basically, yeah, what have you guys heard or questions you guys might have yourselves?
Any question, though? Anything?
Come on, guys. I know you've heard people on campus or in your community. Yeah. What's your name?
Well, my name is Ira.
Okay, Ira.
Yes, and, well, this lady comes up because my brother, he's at med school.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know I have like several questions, like how are we like educating doctors in med school, and why they are doing these doctors? What are they teaching them? And I mean, because I feel that way, the case of the doctors, we have the doctors that are performing them and the women. So what are the statistics of women that are doing that, and why, you know, try to find like a root cause so we can like go there to go to the places if the, I don't know, the 80% is poverty. Then where are these women? Like, where can we find them so, you know, we can educate them?
Mm-hmm.
Like, so, but my question is, like, about doctors. Like, what do they think? Why, when this post viability thing, why are they choosing to kill the baby? Is it hard to give the baby for adoption?
So, in our medical system, okay, so I have a personal family member of mine that's actually going through medical school to become an OBGYN. And how she describes, you know, the whole, this is at UNM, that doctors, they're completely pro-choice. I guess so, saving the life of the child, they're disregarding the fact that child's a human. So most of the time, you're going to get a doctor that says, you know, I'm viewing two patients, not one. But there's a lot of doctors that just view just the mother, and they completely disregard the fact that the child is a human. So their mindset is not even to save the child, it's already dispositioned that it's not even a human, so it's easier to just go get an abortion than to have to pull through with all her pregnancy and so forth. And of course, you know, logically it makes sense that if she does have an abortion, then she doesn't have to deal with the poverty and the whole bit, but that's their initial mindset. And it's actually a huge majority of doctors here at UNM that actually, there's a Nurses for Choice group here at UNM as well. So just in our nursing program for undergraduates, there's an entire group that is nurses for choice.
And one thing before we get to the next question, I'd like to add, there's actually an investigation going on right now with New Mexico Alliance for Life, and they've actually caught the UNM hospital working with the late-term abortion clinic, so they're having med students go to the clinic and practice with late-term abortion, and they're being investigated now for trafficking human organs to the hospital and selling them. So the late-term abortion clinic has clients that they're selling these abortions to, and UNM is profiting. So if you think about it, why would UNM not have women have abortions if they're profiting from that abortion? So it's a deep-rooted issue, and it needs to be exposed. And that's why it's important for you guys to be active in the pro-life movement, to expose these hospitals that we think are great. I mean, they do great things. They're saving people, but they're also in the background, like, where no one's seen, is they're profiting from abortions, from trafficking also. So just to add that. Did you have a question?
It was kind of like, kind of shows you what the uphill battle this is. That even the doctors are saying that it's not a human being in your stomach, and Paul was alluding to this earlier, how it kind of shows you what the future is for the abortion debate. Well, yeah, it's a human, but we're still going to kill it anyways.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of going to be the next question and how you
I actually have
it.
A really good quote. While you're entering, can I look at our Students for Life Facebook page?
Sure.
I have a quote from an abortionist, and it's just what you said. It's the 10 quotes from abortionists.
Does somebody have another question in the meantime?
Yeah, in the meantime.
Daniel Falk?
The one that I've always heard is that the reason that abortion should be kept legal is because without it, then you get back alley coat hanger abortions that endangers the life of a mother more than current procedures do.
Mm-hmm. That is such a hard,
that's the hardest
hard,
one.
Hard one. And you know, we're being trained on answering hard ones like that, but do you feel confident in doing a role play with that? Or would you just
like
the address?
One for me? Obviously.
Well, yeah, I mean, sure, you can.
Yeah, well,
okay.
I mean, that'd be, yeah, it is a tough one to answer, but yeah, sure.
Why don't you be the pro-choice?
Oh, okay.
Hi, I'm Shade, the Students for Life.
Pleasure.
Nice to meet you. So, what do you think about abortion?
I think it's great that women have the right to choose, and I think it's horrible that women like you want to take away rights from your own kind and put them back in chains, take them back in history where they were dying in back alley abortions, where they did it themselves with coat hangers and things like that. You know, abortion may not be a good thing. I agree with you. I wouldn't have an abortion, but you know, it's if we don't have it legal and safe, then you know, women are going to be getting it from sketchy back alley, you know, abortion dealers with coat hangers, and it's just it's safer this way.
Okay. Right. Well, so I can find some. Stop laughing.
Sorry.
I can find common ground with you. I think that women deserve to be safe, and I think women deserve to have rights. Okay, but can I just ask you really quick before I talk about the alley abortions? What do you think the unborn is?
Well, I mean, I think it's. What do you mean? What it is?
So,
fetus.
Okay. What is a fetus? Is it a human or?
Well,
is
biologically,
it
I mean, okay. It's as human as you know, like. Skin cells are human, or you know, we remove wisdom teeth. That's human.
Okay,
that's
okay.
Not bad.
I see where you're coming from. Okay, so is it murder if I go like this and kill skin cells,
no.
Or is it murder if I actually end a life that has a heartbeat and is biologically a human being? Can you see the difference?
Well, neither. It's a clump of cells that
okay.
You know in there. It's not really.
So
it's not a person.
Do you know when is it a clump of cells? I'm interested. Do you know the anatomy of the baby? What it looks like?
Well, actually, I'm a med student.
Oh, okay. So you do know. So
yeah,
when you say clump
of
cells, I'm really confused. When does it look like a human?
I mean, that's a subjective question.
It's subjective.
But,
so do you have the pictures in your textbooks?
I've seen them.
Have you seen
and you know, they look like them. They have little tails, I think.
Okay. Did you know that the heart starts beating 18 days after conception?
Yes.
Okay. Did you know that it has the brain and the organs already functioning at 8 months?
No, I didn't know that. I'm a freshman. So.
Oh, okay. You'd like to be educated. Did you know that by 8 weeks it's already sucking its thumb and it's able to hiccup?
No, I did not know that.
Okay. So is that a clump of cells or is that
a baby? I mean, it's got some great traits. For a clump
okay.
of cells, that's for sure. It's
oh, okay, all right.
Really
well, I think you can agree that it does look like a human. It has human characteristics and it has human DNA.
Hold on. So what you're saying is that it doesn't matter whether or not it's safe for you know women to do it. You're saying that it's always killing, and so we need to ban it. So
what I'm saying is that it is human. Okay. So I just wanted to set that first. Okay. But let's go to the safe and legal abortion. Okay. Abortion is legal. Are you 100% sure that it's safe? Do you have studies that show that it's safe?
It's safer than pregnancy.
Oh, really? So what's your source?
NARAL.
NARAL. Okay. So did you know that there's actually a study done after 2010 that shows that abortion after 20 weeks has a likelier chance to cause a mother death, 50% actually, more than childbirth, which is 12%. And it's even more dangerous than the first trimester as well. And we can argue that abortion is more dangerous for women. We have women that have been killed in Planned Parenthood. We have women that have been killed by abortionists in the East Coast. Some of them are actually in prison for life right now or in trial. So we understand that even though it's legal, it's not safe. There are risks that abortion causes on the female body. What do you think about that?
I mean, I guess I never thought of it that way. I thought it was safe and legal and rare, but yeah, I'll have to look more into
okay.
that.
Do you think it's rare,
I mean,
you just said?
No.
Oh, you don't?
I don't.
Okay. Yeah, did you know that since Roe v. Wade was passed in 1974, over about 60 million babies have died, and about a million die every year.
I'm going to reconsider my position on this.
Okay. Are you pro-life now?
Also, another thing, one thing I usually say if I remember at the time to that is you just kind of bring up what's going on in an abortion. And like I kind of said to her, I don't, you know, how can we make it safer if someone dies every time it happens? Or another thing you can ask is like what Trent Horn does a lot, like on the radio and stuff. He'll say, does the baby end up the same way no matter how it's dismembered? And that kind of brings it back to, okay, what is abortion? What is going on? It's not removing an appendix, you know. And most pro-lifers think it's okay for women to remove appendixes. It's the fact that it's ending a human life, which is bad. And so it's just kind of bringing it back to that. Usually just ask, you know, does the baby end up the same way regardless of how it's dismembered, which, you know, is killed.
And another thing to add to that is we do believe that women should be safe, and we bring it back to the women in the womb. There are women in the womb that are being killed more than men in our country. So we need to also recognize that the women in the womb deserve rights, just like women outside of the womb and men as well as men outside of the womb. So I hope that helps with that argument. We're still learning how to talk about all different arguments, but from what we've learned so far, this is like the most successful way to talk about back alley abortions is that, you know, we need to talk about how abortion is not safe and also how women in the womb deserve to be safe and not killed by abortion.
And usually it's kind of an off-topic question too, because if they acknowledge that it is human being with, you know, equal dignity as that we have as humans, then that wouldn't really be a question for them. You know, killing them no matter how, it would be horrific. And so just convincing them of that is key.
Can I touch on your question?
Yeah.
So I've actually had that exact same conversation. I'm a third-year medical student at UNM. And so Dr. Eve Espy was the associate dean of students my freshman year of medical school, and I actually had several conversations with her relating to the topic of abortion. She is a family practice physician who practices obstetrics, and so she is a staunch advocate for women's reproductive rights. In 2013, she actually received an award from Physicians for Reproductive Health for Abortion Provider of the Year. So this is someone that I've had a significant amount of interaction with in my studies. And so I remember having the conversation with her in her office, talking about, again, abortion issues, and she was talking about bodily autonomy issue in the back alley abortion issue, saying that one of the main reasons that abortion was considered that it became so prominent in the 70s, that it was a social justice issue that affected, so as most people don't know, back alley abortions were very uncommon before Roe versus Wade. The vast majority of abortions, upwards of 90%, were actually performed by physicians in hospitals.
Even before?
Yes, even before Roe versus Wade.
Because medical reasons, mostly.
Well, I mean, even if they were elective abortions, it's just that physicians would do them for you. They would do it, you know, off the books. They would write down the visits being for something else. Very easy, you know, to simply do the procedure in one day, especially an early on one. The later ones, much, much harder to do. But the early ones would very often be done by physicians. And yes, there did exist at times and places, areas with more stringent abortion requirements that it would happen. So the problem was that very often it was the people who did not have health insurance, did not have access to better physicians, so it was generally the wealthier people that were able to get access to abortion, the poor people weren't able to. So it became kind of a race and income issue, in that white people and wealthy people had more access to physicians and therefore were more able to get abortions under medical supervision, whereas blacks poor people were not able to. So again, the argument basically is that the number of abortions before Roe versus Wade and after Roe versus Wade were effectively, the rate did not change very much, especially because doctors were basically performed before, but there were a significant number of people who weren't able to get the abortions. So what you end up having by banning abortion is that after abortion is banned, the abortion rate stays the same roughly because people are very desperate to get abortions because they're in these, you know, very hard life situations. But the maternal death rate goes much, much higher because they're getting abortions from shadier doctors, they're getting abortions on the street from, you know, people that aren't, you know, licensed to practice medicine at all, etc. And so I think yeah, and so there's before, you know, abortion being illegal, heavily restricted versus abortion being legal, they would argue that the reason it's better morally is that the death rate of the fetuses is going to be roughly the same before and after. That banning it is not really effective.
It's got to be far more deadly.
And then after legalizing abortion, the maternal death rate goes down. So your net, even if you include the fetuses as human lives, you're saving net lives. That's one of the portions of the argument. And there is some good evidence to suggest it. And so what I would say in response to that is, well, yes, I mean, it's good that women can get health care that helps them be safe. It is bad for women to die. But should we institute laws that make it safer for someone to murder someone else? Because again, if we're arguing from the position that killing a fetus, that feticide itself is the same as murdering any other type of human being, if that's our argument, then we would just say, well, let's extend this to just people on the street. Do we want to make it, if you have a grudge against someone, you want to go kill them? Do we want to pass a law that would make it so that people who have murderous desire are less likely to get killed by the police or less likely to get killed by the person they're trying to murder in self-defense? And I think that the obvious answer to that is no. We know that murder is wrong. We know that human beings have dignity and that the state and society at large must work to protect their rights and protect their right to continue to live. And that extends to the fetuses. So making one type of murder legal on the grounds that it will save more of the murderers' lives, we would never use that argument in any other situation.
That's really, really great.
That's another, yeah. There are a lot of ways to go with it too.
Yeah.
I
have a quote.
Oh, go ahead.
So, it's Jared, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, so you mentioned how doctors know that it's human, but they're still killing the babies. Mm-hmm. And this is actually on Live Site News, and if you look at Students for Life Facebook page, you can look at this whole article. So it's 10 quotes from abortionists. Okay, the first quote, it's short. I'm going to read you two. So this is from Dr. Randall, former abortionist. Okay, they, the women, are never allowed to look... Oh, I'm sorry. Wrong quote. Dr. Benjamin Kalish, abortionist. Even now, I feel a little peculiar about it. Because as a physician, I was trained to conserve life, and here I am destroying it. So he's recognizing that it's human life that he's destroying. The second one made me cry when I read it. It's very sad to hear, but you have to become a bit schizophrenic. In one room, you encourage the patient that the slight irregularity in the heart is not important. She's going to be fine. The baby is okay and is healthy. Then in the next room, you assure another woman whom you just did a saline abortion that it is good, it's a good thing that the heartbeat is already irregular. There's nothing that she needs to worry about. She will not have a live baby. All of a sudden, one noticed that at the time of the saline infusion, there was a lot of activity in the uterus. That's not a fluid currents. That's obviously the fetus being distressed by swallowing the concentrated salt solution and kicking violently so that it's all intents and purposes the death trauma. Somebody has to do it, and unfortunately, we are the executioners in this instance. And that's from John Seams. So, and it points a good picture, like you said, there still are abortions happening in hospitals, not just in abortion clinics, but you have your OBGYNs. For me, my OBGYN was pro-choice, but you have your OBGYNs that will talk to one patient about, no, your baby's doing fine, it's healthy, it's growing, you know, it's beautiful, and then in another room, they're performing an abortion, or they're referring women to have abortions. And I'm sure that they feel conflicted, a lot of them do. This is the industry that they're in, and that's why it's so important for the pro-life movement to infiltrate not only campuses and talk about abortion and families and communities, but also hospitals. If you are in nursing, if you are a med student and you're pro-life, it's important to talk to these people about what's going on. If you're standing outside abortion clinics, that's why we reach out to these abortionists, because they also need to have that information. So, did you have a question? Anyone else?
Free.
Okay. I thought you did. Anybody?
Oh, go ahead. Quick. Okay, I have a good question. So I have a few friends who claim themselves, you know, Christian, Catholic, but they support the pro-choice movement. They support abortion 100%. And it's something that I deal with daily. It's a daily thing that I have to kind of accept. I don't really know how to argue or discuss yet. So how would you talk to somebody who claims himself as, you know, a Catholic, Christian, Lutheran, whatever, and they also claim themselves as pro-choice, you know, woman's choice, 100%. How would you kind of go? Who has seen the bumper stickers that say you cannot be Christian and be pro-choice? Mm-hmm. Probably seen them everywhere. Well, it's a very true statement. Ideally, you can't claim yourself to be Catholic or Christian and say that you're pro-choice. It goes along, you know, killing a human life is considered to be a sin. And I think that anybody who's religious can agree with that. So it's kind of like the whole, how I view it, it's like when you're compromising with God to try to justify your own statement. So, for instance, because we're Catholic, we believe that sex before marriage is wrong, okay? It's a sin, and it's a moral sin, and that, you have to go through reconciliation to get through it, and it is wrong. We can all agree that the church teaches that it's wrong. It's same with ending a human life or murder. It's part of the Ten Commandments that you do not kill. And the church does teach. I mean, Matt showed us the catechism behind it, that it's wound to the tomb. We believe that life is valuable from conception until natural death. And so Matt, do you have anything to like kind of add about
yeah,
it? He has probably a better explanation.
Well, like, if I would just ask them, you know, do you believe it's wrong? I mean, you can try to top it or two. You just ask them if they believe it's wrong to kill ever, and when is it wrong to kill? And, you know, if they think it's okay, like, they probably don't think it's a human life. Or if they have another issue, then it probably doesn't have to do so much with Christianity. More, though, that they don't recognize that the unborn is a human being. Because, I mean, if it weren't a human being, then there'd be no problem with it. You know, it would be just like an appendicitis or appendectomy. Yeah.
If you're talking to a Christian, the Christian church does not talk about abortion enough. And I'm Christian, and I know. Like, I've been to many churches, and they don't talk about abortion. And that's sad. So a lot of women that are Christian or even Catholic on polls are getting abortions. You know, it's very common. And the church is not there to talk about how it is a sin. And also to talk about coming to the church for help if you're pregnant, and also if you've had an abortion, for forgiveness. So that's something that is kind of in the shadows, and it needs to be brought to light. But if you're talking to a Christian, I would just walk them through the Bible. I mean, the Bible says test everything to the scripture. So if we're talking to a Christian, you know, there are so many instances where God recognizes the unborn. I knit you together in your mother's womb. You know, you were destined for great things. There's so many instances where he values the unborn, where he says children are blessings. So, but like Matt said, it might be just a heart issue. They don't recognize, you know, biologically or philosophically what the unborn is. So maybe just going for that argument and maybe, you know, examining the book that they believe in.
So you mentioned that most abortion clinics don't have the means to save a life if it is in danger. Would you happen to have any statistics on how many abortionists are actually licensed surgical practitioners?
I personally, not on hand.
I do know that most. Oh yeah, please.
So abortion is a medical procedure. So late-term abortionists like Dr. Boyd and the three physicians who practice at his clinic in downtown. They've gone through medical school, and then after medical school, they've done a 4-year residency in obstetrics and gynecology. Then after that, to do the late-term abortions, they've done a fellowship in surgical gynecology, which enables them to do that. So they've had a specific long-term training to develop, and that's 9 years of training after undergrad. For the earlier ones that are more commonly done by family practice physicians and OBGYNs, Those would be like the vacuum ones or just the medical ones where they give them the misoprostol method, Prexate, and so forth. Those abortions are very commonly done by family practice physicians and OBGYNs. And so again, OBGYN, 4 years of training post-medical school, and then family practice, 3 years of training post-medical school.
So the people at the Planned Parenthood Clinic on San Mateo, they have doctors in there doing this,
yeah.
Right?
It is a surgical abortion.
But they also have nurse practitioners that are doing it as well.
They can practice as physicians. They have the same rights in the state of New Mexico as physicians. And so they can do medical abortions.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about the vacuum abortions. But anything that, any surgical abortion has to be done by an OBGYN who's done a fellowship, I believe.
If they have to go into the woman surgically.
Yes.
As opposed to giving her the pill.
I know with the pill, the nurse practitioners at Planned Parenthood are the
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Obstetrics and gynecology is a surgical specialty. So it's a primary care specialty because they deal with women's health care, but it's also a surgical specialty because they do all sorts of things, you know, hysterectomies, ovarectomies, you know, tubal ligations, et cetera, all those things that they do after, you know, like within childbirth, dealing with women's reproductive systems. A lot of it is surgery. So if you do OBGYN, you have surgical training.
And I'd just like to add what you said, the reason why most abortion clinics are not able to save the life of the mother is because most abortion clinics are actually fighting against common laws that make the hallways wide enough for a gurney. There have been instances where women have been having difficulties after the abortion or during the abortion.
They can't get
yeah, botched abortions where they need extreme medical assistance right away and the gurney is not able to go through the hallway and they have died. So that's why I said some clinics are not able to save the life of the mother because they're not equipped properly or they don't have wide enough hallways.
Another good reference as well, if you go on like YouTube or if you've watched, you know, pro-life videos before, they actually have like the undercover 911 phone calls from the Planned Parenthood on San Mateo and also the Southwest Women's Options, where you can actually hear the dispatch call. So it's like the dispatcher saying, oh, what's your emergency? Oh, we just had a 15-year-old, a 16-year-old, 17-year-old that's just had a botched abortion. And so there's, you know, when you get somebody that's like, oh, they don't do that, that's not real, you can always refer them to that, because those are like the actual public 911 phone calls that have actually been taking place.
Because they're breaking the law on minors without parents' permission, or is
it
now legal without parents' permission? But you have to get permission from your parents to have your ears pierced.
Yeah. Or to take an aspirin.
Or get a tattoo. Yeah. Or take aspirin at school. But they can legally abort a 15-year-old baby without telling the parents.
So can we take, I think, Paul had one more question, and I'd just like to say one more thing before we go.
I just wanted to bring up, if I could, two things that came up. One was you referenced it, that the women, more female babies are aborted, even in the United States. It's a huge problem in India. They are, their sex ratio is completely skewed now. It's normally 105 girls to 100 boys, but now it's 123 boys to 100 girls. And it's, they're totally messed up, even though it's against the law. And here, we're supposed to have such equality, and abortion was supposed to bring equality to women, but that's very common among lots of cultural groups, including white people, rich white people, that they abort the baby if it's a girl because they want a boy to carry on the name. Yeah. It's the same problem. The other thing is the blacks.
Yeah, it's a good point.
It's genocide in the black community. The number of blacks in this country is 13% of the population. That is the same number it was when I was in high school. I'm 61.
Well,
where are all of those black babies?
The purpose of Planned Parenthood was
it
to
is
wipe out
racist.
But then also, if you look at the actual locations of Planned Parenthoods, they're placed into those low poverty areas in the higher ethnic areas because ideally that mindset is like still there.
And according to recent polls, about 40-50% of abortions are actually performed on blacks and other minorities. So it is the target, definitely.
Yeah.
I would agree with you. Did you have a question?
I was just going to add to Bree's how some people who are Christian may think that like it's not their place to be pro-life. And I think that stems from they don't, because we live in America and the separation of church and state, they don't believe that they can impose their religion on somebody. But I think the argument against that would be that, you know, even though it's a Christian value like thou shalt not kill, it's a Christian value, we still implement it because it's a universal right, you know, to have your life preserved, to not be killed. Same thing with abortion. You know, if we believe that the fetus is a person, even though it's a Christian value not to, or Christians support it, doesn't mean that we can't implement it.
Yeah. Well, usually when you're talking to somebody, you take it purely from a humane perspective. All of us, we won't bring up religion to somebody until we know that they're okay with it. Just because most people are not going to listen to you if you try to go rub the Bible in their face. They're going to wait. Yeah, I got to wait it out until they're comfortable with it. So you take it strictly from a secular, humane perspective.
Yeah. So probably the hardest argument I've heard is even if a fetus was alive, the right to life doesn't imply a right to use someone else's body. People have the right to refuse to donate their organs, for example, even if doing so would save someone else's life.
Okay, so I think they actually like go over this in like philosophy 101 or something like that. So there are, like someone said earlier about the like accepting that it's human and then saying it's okay anyways. There are a couple ways it goes, and there's sovereign zone arguments, which sound like it's my body, my choice, meaning, you know, this is my sovereign zone, I have ultimate domain over it, I can do whatever I want with it. And there's also right to refuse. And usually people bring up Judith Jarvis Thompson's essay, I think, Defense of Abortion, the year before Roe versus Wade. And it's the violinist argument. Has anyone heard it before? It kind of sounds like a group of music lovers knocks you out over the head, drags you to a hospital, and they hook you up to all these machines, and you wake up, and you're connected with all these funky, weird machines to someone, and they're living off of your kidneys. You're supporting their life. That's their famous violinist that they need to be okay for their performance. And so basically the argument is that while it would be noble to offer your body to help this person, you're not forced to, you know, stay plugged in. Like, you have the right to unplug yourself. So there are a few problems with this. The first is that it's nothing like abortion. Unplugging yourself is not the same as directly killing. And even if they argue that, like, a medical abortion isn't directly killing, usually what I like to say is, you know, let's just say I removed all the oxygen from this room with the intent of killing all of you guys, you know, I'm not directly killing you, but, well, I would say it is directly killing you. So that's basically the idea. One thing to people, like, if they bring up that argument, just say, you know, do you have the right to take a machete and then slice up the violinist because you hate their guts for being there? Like, you can't actively kill them still. And there are a lot of different ways. That's all I want to say.
Yeah, that's good.
And there's a lot of issues.
And then you get back to dependency, like we talked about. You know, does depending on someone make you less valuable? And you can go back to a newborn. You know, newborns need that continuous intervention.
Until a newborn, an 8-year-old.
Yeah.
If you put them out in the forest, they're not coming.
Yeah. My 1-year-old needs me all the time. You know, so it's not right to kill someone just because they need you. So that's the moral of it. Exactly. So, yes.
So, again, as someone who's going into the field of medicine, one perspective many physicians have is a tremendous amount of concern for the mothers and their ability to receive health care. So, for example, there are many situations where, I mean, again, anytime a woman is pregnant, it puts her life at risk. That's simply the fact of it. What's one of the most dangerous things a woman can do is giving birth. There are many complications that can happen. So there are women, they'll have preeclampsia, and if they end up developing eclampsia, you know, they'll end up, you know, they'll end up dying of a stroke or something, you know, hypertensive crisis. There are ectopic pregnancies where they can burst and they can cause a massive peritoneal infection, killing the woman. And there are several other situations like this where it can happen. So one, it would seem that there are cases where ending the woman's state as pregnant, removing the fetus, directly killing the fetus and expelling it, that would actually increase her health. And so what many physicians object to is because they care very much about the health of the mother, and in these situations where very often if the mother dies, the child will die as well, then they view it as inappropriate interference in medical practice because they want to be able to treat the patient with whatever the patient needs for their own health. And so if the patient, you know, has cancer, for example, and required methotrexate to treat that cancer, well, methotrexate will also, as a side effect, from the abortion. And so physicians, what they would not like to see is they would not like to have police come into their medical practice, arrest them, and arrest their patient because they gave their patient methotrexate and their patient took it because they had a tumor and it ended up killing their child, the unborn child. Additionally, like getting into that, there's also a whole host of legal questions about how do we treat abortion if we ever do make it illegal. So, for example, obviously, you know, as a Catholic, I find abortion utterly reprehensible. No physician should ever practice it or legally be allowed to practice it. But women are always going to get pregnant. That's simply the way it is. And a number of women are going to miscarry. We don't know how many pregnancies end in miscarriage. Pregnancies after the third trimester, or after the first trimester, a good fraction of them, maybe even, you know, like more than 10%, like end in miscarriage. When you get before the first trimester, we don't really know because there are many times that women miss periods and they didn't think they were pregnant, you know, they just had a really heavy period and they actually did have, they had a spontaneous abortion and they're unaware of it. So how do we deal with this? Because, you know, if a woman, you know, she was in a hard life position, she's 6 months pregnant and then she has a miscarriage, well, who's to say she didn't go to the doctor did it for her on the download, and he just didn't keep it in his records. So how are the police going to go about, you know, investigating that? So one of the things that people are afraid of is that down the line, if we say, okay, abortion's legal, we recognize fetuses have rights, we're going to go after and aggressively pursue and defend the rights of the fetuses. So does that mean that every time someone dies, especially a young person or someone who's otherwise healthy, they investigate, they do an autopsy, if it was under suspicious circumstances, you know, they open a police report, and then if they decide that it's likely that that person was intentionally killed or negligently killed by someone else, then they press charges against that person. So how is this going to affect women? You know, are women, every time a woman has a spontaneous abortion, is her doctor going to have to report it to the police as an accidental death? Is, you know, she's already in this, you know, tremendously traumatic time, very painful time. Her health is already suffering, and now you're going to add a police investigation on top of it.
Well, they never did that, though.
Well, abortion was
illegal. Nobody ever did that when a woman miscarried or anything.
These are actually concerns that people who are pro-choice have, and I think the way they're legitimate. And beyond that, are you going to say, well, do women need to get pregnancy tests every month? You know, because we know that, you know, we need to catch and make sure, you know, is there going to be a database of every woman who's pregnant, of every woman in the country to, you know, find out if they are pregnant at the moment, if they, you know, miss their pregnancy tests, assume that they're pregnant, we have to go investigate it, make sure they're not out killing their baby. I mean, we have child.
Do people really say that?
Yeah, people are legitimately concerned.
No, not actually.
And, I mean, in my opinion,
they're fascists.
In my opinion, I think these concerns are understandable because if we're going to say we protect the unborn as aggressively and proactively as we protect infants and toddlers and children and adolescents and adults and the elderly, I mean, we have CPS, we have, you know, people who investigate elder abuse and all sorts of the other things. So why, I think it's understandable that you could perceive a society which was, that would go down that path.
And I get what you're saying, Paul, and I've met people that actually confront me with this. But the thing is, like, Shadi presented that there is a huge moral difference between having a miscarriage and purposely having to go in and harm and kill a child for the mother's health. How we were taught is that the only medical issue when it comes to having to actually, I guess, kill the child in terms of saving the mother's life is an ectopic pregnancy with preeclampsia and different those sort of things. Killing the child isn't going to cure all of that. With preeclampsia...
If preeclampsia advances to eclampsia, then ending the pregnancy will...
Preeclampsia doesn't always end in death.
Preeclampsia is incredibly dangerous.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
And so if it gets to the point of eclampsia, you need to... that's what they do.
By the time that she gets eclampsia, like all the way through, the fetus is probably at viability. So at that point, they can do an emergency C-section. They can get the child out in that situation. There's no need to actually go in and do a late-term abortion through this horrific process for it to end the child's life when in reality they could just take it out by C-section. Does that make sense?
I
know you agree with us, which
I think
good.
He's asking
you
about the legal argument.
But then the legal,
that is kind of a tough
of
thing
it,
to answer. Is like, you know, who are you going to go after? And I mean, like Bob said, no one did that before, and I don't think anyone plans to go after women for miscarriages.
No.
I mean, you show women compassion if you've had a miscarriage. You know,
and the moral difference is that, you know, miscarriage is out of your hands. That's nature, and abortion is not natural.
We're going to have to wrap it because it's 8 o'clock.
Yeah. Can I close really quick?
Yep.
I just want to make a quick announcement. So there's going to be a couple bills that are in legislation now. There's going to be a couple hearings. The first one is the late-term abortion ban, and the second one is the Born Alive Act. So there has been evidence at the UNM hospital that babies are being born alive after failed abortions, and they are being left to die. And also, late-term abortion is legal in our state. So if you guys want more information, please like our Facebook page. And if you want to come to the hearing, we need people to speak for the bills because a lot of med students come and they speak against the bills. So if you'd like to be a part of that, please like our Facebook page. And if you didn't sign in already, please do. And if you would like to contact us about possibly coming to Pregnant on Campus and seeing what we do and volunteering, you can also message us on Facebook or email us. Or talk to any of us. But thank you so much
for
listening to us, and I hope that you got some good takeaways.